Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. My name is Professor David Tizzard, and welcome to this next lecture in our course on Eastern and Western culture in Korea. As a prerequisite for this lecture, I've asked you to watch part one of Adam Curtis's BBC documentary, The Century of the Self. Part one looks at the ideas of Sigmund Freud and how they become prevalent in American society through members of his family. Of course, the documentary is quite weird. It's not your typical glitzy, bright, flashy thing that we see on Netflix these days. It's made in a very arresting and difficult format. The sounds, the images constantly jarring us, and it makes me pay attention rather than just kind of sit there and watch it without thinking. Probably that's one of Adam Curtis's intentions by it. Please acknowledge that Adam Curtis is a very well-respected and famed and award-winning documentary maker and filmmaker. Of course, that's not to say that everything that he does or says is correct, but it's to say that he has at least a reasonable, if not a very good, reputation. While the prerequisite that I asked you for this lecture was to watch episode one, I'm going to go through some different ideas. I'm going to go through episode three. There are four parts in total, episode one, two, three, four. I think episode three is probably one of the most interesting and one. Two, not so much in my personal opinion. So you've watched one. I want to go through some of the ideas in part three. That's called There Is a Policeman Inside All Our Heads. He Must Be Destroyed. And I'll also take you through some other ideas. During this, you're trying to understand, is this how the West developed? Is this what happened in the West from a more 심리학적으로, from a psychological perspective? Is this what happened to people? What happened to the individuals? What happened to society? And what happened to the relationship between them? Because if it is, well, okay, then you might have understood something or to what degree it's true. But then you also need to consider, is that also what happened in Korea or in the East, or were there differences? So the West has a longer history of looking at itself in this sense, perhaps. It has a longer history of consumerism, of capitalism. Certainly in that democratic environment, it existed in the West before it existed in the East. That's not to say it's good or bad, it's just a historical observation. So in knowing that, we're trying to see if what happened there, according to Curtis, is true, and whether we can see similar ideas or similar echoes of that in here in the East, or whether it's completely different. So keep that in your mind throughout this. One of the things that you might be interested in, I'm not sure if because of age and things like that, probably many of you won't know what this film is. That's Edward Norton saying, we buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't like. Excellent little pithy quote that sort of describes consumer society. It is, of course, if you don't know, from the movie Fight Club, starring Brad Pitt and Edward Norton. I'm not sure if it's on Netflix, but you could probably find it or get hold of it reasonably easily. It does have some adult themes and content in there, so be careful if you're young. But for what we're looking at now, this is a really good movie. If you're sort of interested in this idea, but you're not quite getting it, you might go and watch Fight Club and then it might click a little bit more to you. Or you might go and watch Fight Club, you might get a different perspective of it. You might go and watch Fight Club and then see some reviews or get a deeper understanding of the movie itself. In Fight Club, it argues that there is a new religion in society. So throughout history, people have sort of, Marx famously says, religion is the opiate of the masses, religion is the thing that drugs people and keeps them calm and keeps them not performing revolutions. What Fight Club argues is that in America, it is consumerism. Consumerism, as in people trying to buy things. So you saw that earlier quote, you buy things even though you don't have the money because you want to impress people. Because it matters whether you have an iPhone 10 or an iPhone 4. That says something about you, perhaps, in our society. If you think about it, really, it shouldn't, but that's what we do. If somebody has a certain product, if they wear these clothes and drive this car and live in this apartment compared to these clothes and this car and this apartment, we evaluate people differently. We see them differently. This is consumerism. And the people, their identity is not intrinsically inside them, but their identity is in the things that they own. And then you get that idea that the things that we own eventually start to own us. That's quite a probably common idea for many of you, and you've also heard opposites like Marie Kondo's minimalism and getting rid of everything. That's also become a trend. Let's have a look at if I can do this one very quick scene from Fight Club and the IKEA lifestyle. And where will this work? Move this here.
Like so many others, I had become a slave to the IKEA nesting instinct.
Yes, I'd like to order the Erica Picari dust ruffles.
If I saw something clever, like a little coffee table in the shape of a yin yang, I had to have it. The Clips personal office unit, the Hovatrack home exerbike, or the Ohanashov sofa with the string green stripe pattern. Even the Rizlampa wire lamps of environmentally friendly unbleached paper. I'd flip through catalogs and wonder what kind of dining set defines me as a person. I had it all, even the glass dishes with tiny bubbles and imperfections, proof that they were crafted by the honest, simple, hardworking indigenous peoples of wherever.
I was holding.
We used to read pornography. Now it was the Horchow collection.
So he says during that scene, I would flick through the catalog and try to work out which coffee table defines me as a person. So this was definitely a rise of the consumer and consumerism as a thing, especially with people going into more and more debt, believing, knowing that we have to buy these things, that if we don't buy these things, then we're not real people, or that we don't measure up, we have to sort of keep up. But we have to consider that it wasn't always like that. This is a rather modern phenomenon. This is something that has arisen rather than something that is natural. And that's what the century of the self is trying to play out to you, how this idea of the modern person, the modern consumer, has arisen. One of the ideas that it does make in episode one and continues out through episode two and three is this idea from Sigmund Freud. And with Freud's psychoanalysis, he makes the point that we are not one, we are not monolith, we are not a single I. That thing that goes around in society speaking and talking and saying I and me and mine. That's one thing. But underneath that, there are emotions, there are other personalities, there are forces that are, in a sense, uncontrollable. And sometimes we don't know they're there, but they act upon us and they influence us. So, for example, you might know that you've got a test tomorrow and so you shouldn't really drink tonight. And you know that. But sometimes you still do it. And then you wake up the next day and you go, oh, why did I do that? But you knew you had the test. You knew that you shouldn't do it. But we still do these things. It might not be drinking. It might be staying up late watching Netflix. And you know you shouldn't do it because you've got an early day or something important. But you do it anyway. So we are controlled by things. We have this rational decision maker. We have this ability to know what is good or bad. A lot of us don't always follow it. We know we shouldn't eat those things, but we eat them. We have moments where we lose self-control. And Freud would say these are other emotions, other forces, other parts of us that come up and control us. So we have these irrational feelings. It's irrational to go drinking before a test. It's irrational to stay up late watching Netflix if you have an important thing. It's irrational to eat loads of chicken and ice cream and pizza if you're trying to look good for Instagram. These things aren't rational, but we do them. And not just like one or two, but that's how most people live. We have this irrational self that controls us. Now, for Sigmund Freud, he believed that these irrational forces were not good. He had a very negative view of human nature. And that shouldn't really surprise us, because during the time that he was lived during World War I and World War II, I believe, just the start of World War II. But he saw World War I and World War II. He saw millions of people die. For what reason? And he would have said, well, humans are essentially irrational. Look at them slaughtering each other in their millions. Humans must be bad. So Freud had a very negative view of these forces and of human nature itself. And so these forces inside us, these irrational things, he believed that they had to be controlled. They had to be kept down. There were two reasons why we have to keep these forces down. One, for the good of us, so we don't do stupid things. And two, so society remains stable, so society doesn't go into chaos. So as an individual, Freud wanted people to control these inner forces, but he also wanted society to control these forces. He thought that people must be kept calm. People's inner selves, people's inner characters must be kept down. They must be kept repressed. We must sort of stop people from exploring them too much, because who knows what might happen if all of these thoughts and feelings and things come out. I think it would be interesting to look at that from an Eastern perspective if you consider that certainly during the late stages of the Joseon Dynasty, society was quite repressive with the rules, with the slavery, and many people wouldn't have been able to express themselves for fear of being beaten or whipped or killed by the Yangban. And of course, that would have been in other societies as well, but very repressive. And then Japanese colonialism, in which certainly from about 1930 onwards, as Japan increased their militarization for war, there was no Korean names, there was no Korean language, trying to erase the Korean history. That would have also, and people wouldn't really have been able to speak out, so that would have kept all of these emotions, these irrational things, really pressed down. And then you get the authoritarianism of Isungman, of Park Chung-hee, of Chun-do-won, and again, people would not really have been free, able, open to express themselves, because you could get killed, you could get taken to Namsan. If you said, well, maybe socialism's got some good things about it, maybe the president's not very good, that would be a dangerous thing to do at those times. So for Koreans, that inner self would have constantly been kept down. And that repression might then lead to different things that we see today. Wilhelm Reich has a very checkered history. He originally opposed Freud's ideas. And it was him originally, but then other people sort of took it from him. Wilhelm Reich had a very troubled history. But his idea was that this inner self, these emotions, these personalities inside of us, these multiples, should not be repressed. In fact, we should encourage them. When we have these thoughts and these feelings, we should be more in tune with them. We should pay attention to what these feelings say. Now, if you consider, you do get two types of approach to life. You'll get some people that are very rational, very logical, and that's how they want decisions to be made. Other people often base decisions more on feelings and emotions. This is kind of going into the difference between Freud and Reich, in that Freud would say, yeah, we have these emotions, yeah, we have these feelings that we should do things, but no, we should not, because we need to make rational, clear, and logical decisions. Whereas Wilhelm Reich was saying, go with your gut, trust your feelings. It doesn't matter if everybody tells you you're wrong, if that's what's in there, if all of these things are building up, let them out, let them come out, speak your truth, be you. Because ultimately, Wilhelm Reich, excuse me, believed that the forces inside of us were good. A positive view of human nature. And the reason society was, you know, not perfect was because everybody was repressing themselves. Everybody was holding these things down. So if people started opening up, then society would be better. The reason society wasn't good because there was too much repression. And so the answer for this was to unleash these forces and let them come out into the world. So you take the 1960s in the United States or in the West, and the people, they wanted to get away from the state. They wanted to get away from the man. They wanted to get away from control. They wanted to be free. They wanted revolution. They wanted this new kind of life and existence. And what they believed was corporations, mass media, advertisements were controlling them, were forcing them to think certain things. So it's kind of like gusongjui, constructivism, that the images and the labels and the signs and the symbols, these were all influencing people to think certain things. What should a man be? What should a woman be? What is the correct job? Who should you vote for? People were afraid that these symbols were becoming too powerful, that media was controlling how people think and how people feel. And the question was, how could you get away from that? And we know that social media and media today is everywhere, actually. It's even worse now in 2020, because most of the time, as soon as you get a free couple of minutes, you'll scroll through social media and you get told what's cool, you get told what to think. You don't have to agree with what you're told by these things, but you will see images and narratives and ideas from that media, even if it's on Insta, if it's on Twitter or Facebook or Naver or Dam, these things will come to you and tell you these things. Back then in the 60s, it was only sort of billboard advertisements and a bit of TV and radio, but for those people, it was already too much. It was already too much control. So they wanted to get the policeman out of their head. They wanted to get that conscience, that rule maker that was in there. They wanted to get that out. That's a really interesting idea, that people wanted that. One of the things that people started reading or moving with this was Herbert Marcuse and his work, One Dimensional Man. Now, Marcuse was very influential. He was kind of like a post-Marxist. You'll find a lot of modern thinkers are not. He's very divisive, Marcuse. Some people love Marcuse, some people hate Marcuse. Some people think he's responsible for all the division and identity politics and everything wrong with the world. Other people think he was very important at the time for developing Marxist thought and bringing it into a new environment, into that Cold War world. So it's impossible to say Marcuse is good or bad from an objective perspective. It kind of depends where you stand. You make up your own minds on that. But let's have a look at some of his ideas, because they tie in quite a bit with what Curtis covers in his documentary. Marcuse says, the people recognize themselves in their commodities. They find their soul in their automobile, hi-fi set, split-level home, kitchen equipment. So you can see this idea. It's the same as the Fight Club IKEA. What is the kitchen table that defines who I am? And you can see that replacement of religion. Marcuse is, specifically, he mentions the soul, kind of like hon, yeah, soul. That was the thing that would define us according to traditional Christian beliefs. Or even in Hinduism, you get the Atman. But that was what defined us, this kind of soul or this special nature. If you were liberalism, it was your ability to think rationally or the potential to think rationally. So Christians believed in the soul, and the liberals believed in rationality. These are the things that defined you. But in this part, it was not things inside you, either your mind or your soul, your being, that defined you. It was the things that you had. It was these things that defined who you were and said what kind of person you were. It was the external things rather than internal. So the power is not in the individual anymore. The power is not in the person. The power is outside. The power is in the corporations, in the companies. This is about Marcuse. You can see him here with Alison. Have to forgive me, I've forgotten the name of that. It will come to me soon, I'm sure. He spoke to a deep sense of alienation. The pure form of servitude, he wrote, is to exist as an instrument, as a thing. And this mode of existence is not abrogated if the thing is animated and chooses its material and intellectual food, if it does not feel its being a thing, if it is a pretty clean mobile thing. Moreover, free election of masters does not abolish the masters or the slaves. The society without opposition, Marcuse described, was mobilized against the enemy to the point of threatening all-out nuclear destruction. It was based on the supreme promise of an ever more comfortable life for an ever-growing number of people who, in a strict sense, cannot imagine a qualitatively different universe or discourse in action. Their many liberties and comforts only perpetuated and intensified their subjection to the productive apparatus. So we get this idea that people, individuals, exist as an instrument, exist as a thing, or exist as a tool. You'll get this idea with Pink Floyd. I should show you this, really. Another Brick in the Wall, which is a very famous song from, what, I'm saying, 1970s? Get my dates wrong. By Pink Floyd, the British kind of prog rock band. Go and watch the music video of that. It must be latest 80s. Fantastic idea, but speaking to similar things here. And a rejection of democracy in the free election. Having a democracy in which you elect politicians does not get rid of this kind of gap all, this hierarchy, this masters and slaves. This was a big way of thinking for Marx and also Kojève, with the ideas that the lower class had to overtake the upper class in order for society to move on. So the working class, the laborers, the proletariat, they had to take over the bourgeoisie. And when they did that, society would go to its next thing. For Marx, society always moved on, whether it was through the traditional stages, through the feudal stages. Society always moved when the slaves were able to sort of overtake the master. It was decided by class. When the class went up, when the classes changed, that was when you go forward in time, in history. And for him, after capitalism, for Marx, after capitalism, you get the communism is the last stage in history. It's the end of history. That's the Fukuyaman idea. That because it's always masters and slaves fighting each other, once you get rid of masters and slaves and everybody's equal, there's no more history to do. That's the end. The whole point of it is to get rid of that Mokechung, Kabul, get rid of the hierarchy, get rid of those, and then that's it, for Marx at least. And Marcuse certainly uses similar language. Society without opposition was mobilized against an enemy. So if you look at, let's say, America, there's always an enemy to fight. Society creates an enemy with which to focus everybody. So if you look throughout history, or even the last couple of decades, America has had the Soviet Union and Vietnam, and it's had Iraq, it's had Saddam Hussein, it's had Colonel Gaddafi, it's had Kim Jong-il, Kim Jong-un, Osama bin Laden. There's always an enemy. There's always a focus. There's always an other for these societies. And having that other sort of brings people together, because people have this hate. People have this fear. People have these irrational feelings that they're not doing very well in society. These people are really rich and these people have great houses, but I'm just here. But we're in it together because we share a common enemy. Interesting to consider what we see at the moment with America is that there's not a common enemy. And so that might be why this view has sort of looked internally at American society, and instead of seeing external enemies, that now, well, there's internal enemies. Now, instead of seeing the people over the other side of the world, the Asians or the Russians or the Middle Easterns, because they're not the enemies anymore, well, maybe you're the enemy then. They find them closer to home. Maybe there's an argument that for internal stability, you create an external enemy. And you could look at this at the state level or the individual level. For internal stability, you create an external enemy. And the enemy becomes the other. So this is us and that's the enemy over there. You could probably see similar things in South Korea. For a lot of time, the other, the enemy was North Korea. That drove a lot of conversation. That drove, you know, the Dongilbap and everything. That was what South Korea was based on. But if the current administration, President Moon, is going to try to get close with North Korea, perhaps even try to, you know, welcome North Korea in and get the land and the people and the money, then we need another. Because otherwise, well, there's lots of problems in South Korean society. Whether you take the growing economic inequality, whether you take the gender inequality, the suppression and oppression that women face from that, whether you take the kind of heinous and tragic and appalling sex crimes that keep going on, we've seen that there are quite a few problems in Korean society. And they could be very damaging. However, if there's an external enemy, well, we'll go together and we won't think about our problems, we'll focus on that one. So we'll make that one Japan. And I'm not saying Japan isn't bad, or I'm not saying Japan isn't good, but I'm saying there needs to be, perhaps for internal stability, there needs to be an external focus. That's how that might work. Marcuse says here, just finally, that people cannot imagine a different universe, a different conversation, a different action. You can't imagine anything else. All you can imagine is the current system and just making it fairer. So we've got this current system, but you guys have got all the money and we live terribly and there's let's say, racial inequality and gender and cultural and ethnic, we just try to make it a little bit fairer. There's no new system. There's no new way. There's no new thinking. You're stuck inside where you're, whatever you do, you're always going to keep the system continuing. And maybe that's a good thing. Maybe we don't want anarchy. We don't want chaos, because the thing that replaces it might be even worse. Look at what happened in the Soviet Union under Stalin, or Chairman Mao's China. Millions, tens of millions all dead. The thing, the revolution that came, was disastrous. It was murderous. And then it came to other places. But Marcuse makes the point that we can't think about anything else other than continuing the current system. And that's why people like Bauman, who wrote Liquid Modernity, would say that we're still kind of in modernity. We haven't got to anything like post-modernity or anything like that. We're still stuck in this way of thinking. Marcuse says this: the distinguishing feature of advanced industrial society is its effective suffocation of those needs which demand liberation. Liberation also from that which is tolerable and rewarding and comfortable, while it sustains and absolves the destructive power and repressive function of the affluent society. Here, the social controls exact the overwhelming need for the production and consumption of waste, the need for stupefying work where it is no longer a real necessity, the need for modes of relaxation which soothe and prolong this stupefaction, the need for maintaining such deceptive liberties as free competition at administered prices, a free press which censors itself, free choice between brands and gadgets. He's making the point here that things aren't free. The free press doesn't say the things that we want. The free competition, the prices are set between the big companies. The free choice to buy anything we want on the shelf in the supermarket, and you can't buy anything else. That in freedom, you're getting this idea that paradoxically, freedom is slavery. So the personal becomes political is very much an idea that gets associated with feminism, which is very true. It's been used by a lot of different movements, and it was used during this kind of ideational, this idea revolution that Curtis documents in the 60s. Now, the people were worried that the media was too powerful. They were worried that they were just being... they had no choice. They had no freedoms. They just had to think what the media told them. They had to believe the newspapers. But people didn't believe the newspapers. Some people didn't trust the politicians. It's like when you grow up, you come to a stage where you don't believe in Father Christmas or Santa Claus anymore. When you're a kid, you do. And then you kind of grow up and you're like, oh, that was, oh, that's like that. Okay. And as you grow up, you might get to a stage where you see that your parents are fallible, that they're not, they don't always have lots of money, or they don't always make the perfect decision. They might be emotional or do bad things. And then you're like, okay, so parents are just humans. You start seeing these things that you once believed were always perfect or this great thing. You start seeing them a little bit different. It's like the Wizard of Oz. You look behind the curtain and you see that it's really quite a just simple, normal thing. And it's not that great what you thought. It's not as great as you thought it would be. And that happens with politicians. As you grow up, you realize, well, politicians aren't really that special. They're not like a different breed of humans. They're greedy, they're selfish, they make mistakes, they're irrational, they're just like you and me. And so we start seeing those things differently. And when we look at the media, when we look at the news, as we get older, our trust in these things seems to go down. And so we don't want to be controlled by them anymore. We want to try to get away from that. We want to grow up. We want to get away from Santa Claus's society. We want to be ourselves. But the problem was, people couldn't overcome the state. The state has guns. The state has police. The state has army. The state has logistics, and it has arranged forces and communication. It's hard for the individuals to defeat the state. You're seeing that at the moment with the current situations, the riots. There can be fracases and people can do things, but the state is essentially very big and very powerful. It's very hard for humans to overcome the state. So what happened was the people decided, well, if we can't overcome the state, if we can't get that thing that's controlling us, we'll just change ourselves. Instead of changing the society that we live in, we'll change ourselves. This was meant to be sort of like a palace or something, or a castle. So the people realized that the state is too well protected. It's too highly defended. They can't sort of get in there and change that. So they're stuck in this. Well, we can't take down that. That's going to still keep making the rules. That's still going to keep making CNN, Fox News, BBC, Zhongang Ilbo, Hangyure, dung. Can't control that. So what we have to control instead is we have to control our minds. This thing in here, we have to get rid of it. We have to free our minds. We have to become an individual. Not a citizen, an individual. Because a citizen is a product of the state. A citizen has allegiance to the state. A citizen is lower than the state. An individual is different. An individual has free will. An individual has autonomy. An individual can act, can say, can do, can be whatever they want. This is the arrival of the self. This is the century of the self, as Curtis describes it. But what if that self that arises, that sounds so powerful, that sounds so nice, I'm going to be a free thinking individual, I'm going to stand on my own two feet, not believe in Santa Claus anymore. What if that means you're more trapped than you were before? That's the paradox. That's the problem that we get. That's what Fight Club talks about. That's what Trainspotting, I'll show you in a minute, talks about. And what people believed was that if enough people did this, if enough people change the way they think, if enough people became enlightened, there would be enlightened, woke, whichever language that you want to use, it's the same thing. If enough people took that view of against the state, of being a free thinker, then society would just tip that way. There wouldn't be a big revolution, there would be no charging, there would be none of this, but as soon as enough people thought the same way, then that's how it would go. So there was no kind of organized movement, but it was just waiting until the message got into enough people's head. That was the goal of it. So following Wilhelm Reich's ideas, so Freud was all about keeping these things down, keeping down your anger, keeping down your frustration, keeping down your sexuality, keeping down your homosexuality, keeping down your jealousy, keeping down your frustration. Wilhelm Reich was like, no, let that all out. You know, let's start shouting. Let's start feeling that. You're frustrated. You feel that that's injustice. You feel, go and do it. Go and find those forces in you. You feel that you're a man or you're a woman, or you feel that you have feelings for these kind of people. Explore them. Don't repress them, but bring them out. And doing this will give you autonomy. Doing this will give you control. And it will give you control of what? It will give you control of yourself. And you get control of yourself by letting these forces coming out, being who you really are. See your true colors shining. Because only the individual matters. There is no society in this view. Society doesn't matter. The individual is king. The individual's rights have to be above society. And this isn't selfish. It's the ultimate goal of this. And again, I'm not saying this is good or bad. I'm trying to go through the ideas in Curtis's documentary to show how the West is where it is today. But that one of the key points is that the individual is king. The individual's wishes, desires are more important than society, law, science, and so on. And if everybody starts living like this, well, because that's a very difficult thing to do. It's a very difficult thing to sort of stick up a middle finger and say, well, I reject society, the law, and science, and it's all a power structure. It's all a patriarchy, a hierarchy, a white supremacist hierarchy, a Yangban hierarchy, because obviously in South Korea it wouldn't be a white supremacist, or it might be a patriarchy. To reject all of those things and focus on what the individual wants and needs, that's a very difficult thing to do. But the idea was that that was the ultimate goal. And if enough people did that, that would be the way forward for society. That would change it. With this kind of preoccupation with the self, you probably recognize this here, because that was what people were doing. The self was becoming the most important, not society, but the self. So there was always that balance. And you've probably seen that taking place in South Korea with the rise of Hon, with the rise of Sabasa. All these ideas of the self is coming out, and you have these social duties, you have these tegims, you have these responsibilities where in the past you couldn't avoid them. If like the Bujangnim, or if the Onni, or if the halabodi said, 오늘 저녁, you had to go, 아, 예, 알겠습니다. You had to do it. But that self is coming out now. And more than that, people are starting to dress differently. They're starting to get tattoos. They're starting to get piercings. And that's a different conversation, because if they all get similar tattoos and if they all get similar piercings, then how much individualization is going on in that? That's a different conversation. But this idea of self-expression, you see this by the 1980s, most people defined themselves in the United States as an individual rather than as a member of society. So that revolution in the 60s, it was more about I'm a person rather than I'm a part of a group. The self had been liberated. And the top of Maslow's hierarchy of needs is self-realization, in that the people believed that they were moral, creative, spontaneous, that they didn't have prejudice, that they were good. This is how people started to feel about themselves. Yeah, I'm a creative being. I'm a special person. I can live. I can express myself. That's who I am. And this view of the self, interestingly, it cut across all social classes. So previously, you might have conservatives and liberals. You might have rich and you might have poor. You might have white and you might have black. You might have young and you might have old. There were different classes and demographics in society. But this idea of the self, this idea of the self coming out, this cut across all of these. Didn't matter if you were Bosudang or Jimbodang. Didn't matter if you were really rich or really poor. Didn't matter what sort of ethnicity or things like that you were. This affected everybody. So instead of all these traditional parts of society, there was this new one that arisen. There was this new group, and it was the individual. And so this meant that business had to change, because business would have been, or commerce, production, business was based on mass production. We've got this one thing, and we'll produce 10 million of them, and everyone's got to buy the same one. You want a chair? There's the chair. There's no choice. You want a car? You go and buy a Ford. You want a TV? You go and buy this TV. But that didn't tie in with what people were doing before. When people were part of a society, they thought, okay, we'll all have the same chair, the same TV, the same house. We'll live the same way. We'll have the same family. We'll all have a husband and wife and two kids and a dog. There's not much choice going on. But as people were becoming, as the self was coming out, then they wanted different products from the other people. Well, I'm an individual and creative, so I don't want the same car as that person. I don't want the same iPhone as that person. I want to be able to make a choice. And that choice that I make defines who I am. So you can see that there's a clash between those ideas. What people discovered, what the businesses discovered, is that, to them at least, all of these people saying, I'm an individual, I want to be myself, there was not, if you got 51 million people in South Korea, there weren't 51 million individuals. They discovered that there were types of individuals, just like you get blood types, or just like you get, what's he? Yongdi, Dakdi, Horangidi, ding, ding, ding. You get zodiacs or star signs. There's a set number. And that's what the businesses and companies realized. So they discovered that there were these inner directed people. So this is the vows, the values and lifestyles. So this word, lifestyle, this comes out of the personality types. I forget what the initials are, but like you do the IMBT personality tests, and it tells you which one you are out of the 12. These are the same things, but just before that. And what it told people is that what are the things that they want to buy, the things that they want to consume. So these inner directed people that were focused on themselves, they were focused on this inner, who they are. I am me. Nah, nah, nah. They were egocentric. They were young. They were individualistic. Or the experiential people. They wanted experience and involvement. They wanted to go and go bungee jumping, rollerblading, snowboarding. These are the things. These eccentric, young, individualistic. They want piercings and tattoos. They want to go to festivals. They want to dye their hair and join a club. Or the societally conscious lifestyle. They want to be a fundraiser for the WHO. They want to do these kind of jobs because that defines them. The businesses realized that these were the people. There were people like this. And so they could analyze them, and then they started targeting goods for these people. So people would then buy these, and people then would become those values. So it's like circular logic. There are these kind of people. So we'll make goods for these type of people, and then people buy those goods, and then people start living like that. And so now we've just got these people. We can control these people. We haven't got 51 million individuals, but we've got, let's say, 9 types that we can sort of control. So the businesses could predict which products people would buy. We've got this product. We need to advertise it to people. How can we do that? One of the stories in episode 1, I think it is that they just made people add an egg. So there was a mixture to make a cake, and everybody felt like they weren't really cooking because they were just pouring things in without doing anything. So they felt guilty. And so they said, well, add an egg. And then people felt like they contributed. They were doing something. That was their special touch, their special egg. and I'll go and get some nice eggs, and I prepared these eggs, so that's my love. And it worked. So businesses could market towards these things, but they could also start creating politicians, creating values which people would vote for. So they could say, well, we've got lots of these people in society. We need to use certain language and certain ideas to attract these people. All these people in society, how are we going to get them to vote for us? How are we going to get them to believe in Mr. X or Mr. Y or Mrs. Z or Mrs. A? How do we do that? Well, we'll use certain language and ideas that resonate with them. It's the new IKEA coffee table that you see in Fight Club. So instead of just attracting people through gender, instead of attracting people through economic class, or instead of attracting people through religion, now they could get a much bigger group of people. And the documentary points out this is why Reagan and Thatcher were elected, because they promised, you will be the individual. We'll do it for the individual, not for society. That was the message that they were elected on. And that was, everybody at the time wanted to be an individual. And so it was very successful. Trainspotting is a very famous film that is probably, whereas Fight Club is kind of violent, has adult themes, this is very adult themes. But it goes into the same ideas. I'll show you a clip from, if I can, Trainspotting 2, rather than Trainspotting 1. Trainspotting 1 is the better film, but a little clip from Trainspotting 2.
Choose life.
Choose life was a well-meaning slogan from a 1980s anti-drug campaign. And we used to add things to it. So I might say, for example, choose designer lingerie in the vain hope of kicking some life back into a dead relationship. Choose handbags. Choose high-heeled shoes, cashmere and silk to make yourself feel what passes for happy. Choose an iPhone made in China by a woman who jumped out of a window and stick it in the pocket of your jacket fresh from a South Asian fire trap. Choose Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat, Instagram, and 1,000 other ways to spew your bile across people you've never met. Choose updating your profile. Tell the world what you had for breakfast and hope that someone somewhere cares. Choose looking up old flames, desperate to believe that you don't look as bad as they do. Choose live blogging from your first wank to your last breath. Human interaction reduced to nothing more than data. Choose 10 things you never knew about celebrities who'd had surgery. Choose screaming about abortion. Choose rape jokes, slut shaming, revenge porn, and an endless tide of depressing misogyny. Choose 9/11 never happened, and if it did, it was the Jews. Choose a zero-hour contract and a two-hour journey to work, and choose the same for your kids, only worse, and maybe tell yourself it's better that they never happened. And then sit back and smother the pain with an unknown dose of an unknown drug made in somebody's fucking kitchen. Choose unfulfilled promise and wishing you'd done it all differently. Choose never learning from your own mistakes. Choose watching history repeat itself. Choose the slow reconciliation towards what you can get rather than what you always hoped for. Settle for less and keep a brave face on it. Choose disappointment and choose losing the ones you loved. And as they fall from view, a piece of you dies with them. Until you can see that one day in the future, piece by piece, they will all be gone, and there'll be nothing left of you to call alive or dead. Choose your future, Veronica. Choose life. Anyway, it amused us at the time.
Choose life. This idea that you can choose whatever you want, but you're only going to choose things that, a bit like the Fight Club one, that aren't going to make you happy. And you can't really choose anything. You're just choosing what other people are choosing. You're trapped in this system. So what does it all mean? It's a very existential way of thinking about it. But it's also very nihilistic, because you become, well, then what do I do? Do I live in the system? Do I reject the system? I think the broader point that we're trying to make here is that you can see this happening in the West, and Curtis documents this in the West. He documents the rise of the individual and how this came about in his ideas through this psychological awakening, or this battle between whether human nature is good or bad, between Freud and Wilhelm Reich, what we should do with these forces, and then how the rise of the individual doesn't really lead anyway. It doesn't lead to the promised land. The individual comes up, but then people criticize that idea. Then where does it go? It doesn't go anywhere, because we become trapped. We become tools. We become products. We become the very thing that we're trying to escape from. That's a very interesting thing to consider. And you might want to think about, does that happen in... Do two countries, do two cultures have completely different journeys, and there's no connection between them, so we can't compare? Or do we see parallels? Do we see where that's going? Has sort of South Korea made Fight Club? Has it made Trainspotting? Maybe Bong Joon-ho with his films like Okja sort of go a little bit close to it, or Snowpiercer. These, you get sort of those very rejection of capitalism, you get this desire for a new thing. Certainly Snowpiercer at the end, where they escape from the system and go out into the new world. And again, I'm not saying this is good or bad, but how prevalent these ideas are in society, and how and when they happen, what drives them, and what the results are, and whether they're comparable, whether we can learn anything from each other's experiences in them. Focus groups, we've nearly finished. I'll wrap this up as we're on to about an hour. So if you get this, capitalism creates products that helps people be themselves. So capitalism creates all of these different things so we can be ourselves. And if you look around your house, you'll see all the stuff that you have, and the stuff defines you. And when you go from here to here, you've got to take some stuff with you. What stuff do you need? Well, it depends. If you're going for 1 week, you need this much stuff. And if you're going for just 30 minutes, you need this much stuff. But you need stuff. You need your things. And you'll notice that your stuff is different from other people's stuff. And the other people's stuff sometimes looks great, but sometimes it's like, no, I want my stuff, please. My stuff makes me happy. So we get attracted to the things, and our identity comes in the stuff. But if there can be unlimited consumer needs, if there can be different things, I want a green pen, I want a red pen, I want a green pen with an umbrella on the top, I want a Hello Kitty t-shirt, I want a Pikachu pair of socks, I want a Super Mario toilet, capitalism will never end. And again, that's not saying that's a good thing or a bad thing, but these things are unlimited. We can keep producing and making these things as long as people believe that they want them, as long as people believe that they are defined by these things. That reifies the system, that keeps it going. So as the individual becomes liberated, as the self arises in the century, then it becomes more dependent on business and capitalism to express itself. Because previously it would express itself, people would express themselves in society, they would express themselves in relation to other people, they would express themselves in relation to their God, in relation to their ideology. But by becoming an individual and standing there, you realize, I need some things to define myself. And what better way to do that than to buy stuff? I'll stop here, as I'm up to an hour on this. This is not to say whether one is good or bad. I've tried to walk a fine line between all this without sort of pushing you to this side or that side, but rather you've probably gone into it with a side, and that's been reinforced. So some people would have been like this at the start, and they would have gone that way, and some people would have gone further that way. Hopefully the lecture affects people differently rather than makes everybody think the same thing. I would encourage you to, you know, that Century of the Self documentary by Adam Curtis. I know it's a bit weird. I know it's a bit hard. It's not flashy and glitzy, but you'd probably learn a lot about East and West culture if you could watch a little bit more of it. Maybe go up to episode 3 and try that. Try episode 2, try episode 4. He also does some great work. There's one called Hypernormalization. It's a fantastic one. That's just one episode of about 2.5 hours. And yeah, some of the stuff that he makes is probably something that you will never see elsewhere. It's very unique. You've either seen it or you haven't seen it. It's not like you can see similar things. It's you see it or you don't see it. So I would encourage you to watch it, especially as you're part of an East and West course. These things will greatly increase your understanding. As for now, I'll stop now. I agree that this is probably a little bit hard. It's a bit harder than watching BBC documentaries about, you know, education and things. But I'm sure some of you, that's kind of challenged you or pushed you. And, you know, we sometimes have an academic responsibility to see how far some of the classmates in this class can go. So I've put up an announcement about the exams in the end of the semester. So if you have any questions about that, please let me know. And I'll try to put up some specific guidelines for the final assignment. But if you are confused, go back to that video that I made a while ago, How to Produce Outstanding Work. It's on my YouTube channel. That's a really important thing. It's the same ideas from the midterm. Check that out. Also, there's an online sangnam this Friday if you need it or if you want it. I'll stop here. Best of luck with everything. Hope you're learning something about West culture and East culture as well. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, and goodbye.